An ABC crew was in town yesterday reporting on the controversy surrounding earthquake demolitions. Their story was aired on national television last night. Margaret Henry, an outspoken member of the Citizens Earthquake Action Committee, spoke of her fears that Newcastle was about to fall prey to frustrated developers, becoming a city of modern high-rise buildings akin to Parramatta or Chatswood in Sydney. Today, an angry Lord Mayor hit back in a strongly worded letter to the ABC 7:30 report. "Your story," he said, "chose to present at length the personal view of a foul political candidate with a chip on her shoulder." He went on to say most Novocastrians would be ashamed and revolted by Mrs. Henry's admission that her first tear for Newcastle was prompted by the demolition of the George Hotel. The Lord Mayor's tears, the letter said, were for the families and friends of the dead and injured. In a final barb, Alderman McNaughton said the report went for the cheap shot, the easy sneer. He called it an affront to Australian decency. There were strong words too today from another Newcastle alderman. An angry Frank Rigby condemned the New South Wales Planning Department for the delay in ruling on demolition works at Carrington Chambers. "Valuable tradesmen and machinery are lying idle," he says, while the experts ponder over the importance of suspected convict ruins.
"All I know is that it doesn't take a week. Our health inspector and our building and health inspector is giving building approvals on the site. It's taking 5 minutes to get a building approval. Well, surely they can do this in at least a week and a half. And it's just been too long."
The Navy's presence was made quite evident this afternoon with the arrival in port of three RAN vessels, HMAS's Curlew and Shoalwater, both minehunters, and the landing craft Betano. The Navy will get festivities underway tomorrow night with the ceremonial sunset beating to quarters on the foreshore. On Saturday and Sunday, there'll be fun for young and old with all nature of water sport events and even a family fishing competition. Another highlight of the weekend will be the staging of the Australian Grand Prix Formula One powerboat races on the harbour, halting all commercial shipping activities. And there'll be plenty for landlubbers too.
There's a number of varied activities on shore, such as there's a gemstone display, working gemstone display down there, adventurous scouts displays. There's really a million and one things, but the water's the big thing for this year. There's lots and lots happening on the water, and Navy Weekend in Newcastle, of course, is one of those.
Attracting record crowds and enjoying a better than average year on the paddock doesn't necessarily pay all the bills, and support from sponsors is an integral part of modern day sport. Today's leaked announcement in the Daily Telegraph sees the oil company BP signing with the Knights for a six-figure sum and for a lengthy term. It is understood that the new deal will offset a $120,000 backlash from two sponsors last year who didn't follow through on their agreement. The BP logo will be carried on the sleeve of the Knights' jumpers. This was made possible by a relaxation on sponsorship deals by the New South Wales Rugby League. After suffering heavy losses last financial year, the Blue and Reds have welcomed with open arms the new arrangement. Chairman of the Newcastle Knights, Max Fox, would not comment on the announcement today, as the official launch of the sponsorship is next Tuesday. However, he did confirm that BP will be in the camp this year and have pledged a considerable sum of money.
As the crowd lined the barriers waiting for the Prime Minister, a single plane flew overhead, trailing a banner proclaiming shame on Mr Hawke. But the PM wasn't bothered, nor the many well-wishers who greeted him. In a simple ceremony, 26 people took the oath of allegiance to the Queen, becoming Australian citizens, each personally congratulated by Mr Hawke. Four local VIPs won the crowd's approval and a vote of thanks from the Prime Minister. The World War I diggers will travel with Mr Hawke to Turkey this year to mark the 75th anniversary of the Gallipoli landing. In his address to the crowd, Mr Hawke said the Anzac spirit gave birth to Australia's sense of nationhood. Then the ceremony that took place across the country today. Flanked by 96-year-old Charlie Cambridge, Mr Hawke raised the Australian flag. There were some tense moments for Mr Hawke's minders, as autograph hunters and well-wishers pushed forward. Shades of the PM's past encounters haunted him, but most were just anxious to shake hands with the country's leader. The Prime Minister refused to be drawn on national politics, dodging questions on Bougainville and the opposition's health policy. With this, he pushed his way to the waiting car with a parting apolitical comment on his day.
While the powerboats roared it out on the water, the foreshore was a hive of activity. Stalls and displays lined Wharf Road, and the Navy provided two ships for inspection. There was a family fishing competition, kites, and a demonstration by the MG Car Club. Something for everyone, even a miniature harbour which attracted as much attention as the real thing. And in contrast to the motoring technology on the harbour, a display of vintage farm machinery. Sharing the harbour with the powerboats was William IV and the Lady Joy. The Eye Newcastle even made a surprise guest appearance and stopped proceedings for a short while. The sailed training ship Seven was greeted by local children as it docked at the foreshore. Symbols of hope, rebirth and unity were taken from the boat and presented to local dignitaries. The didgeridoo, seeds and a Bible which were brought from England during the First Fleet reenactment will be displayed in the Hunter Mall. The fire is located in inaccessible wetlands between Hexham and Shortland. Attempts since Thursday to reach the heart of the blaze prove fruitless. Brigade officials have had no choice but to let the blaze take its course while they keep a close eye on nearby property. However, this morning's stiff breeze whipped up the fire, causing anxious moments for residents. For 2 hours, the Westpac helicopter waterbombed the blaze, successfully putting out a large section. Tonight, the blaze is still burning on two fronts. Taro Brigade is on standby in case the wind changes and once again property is threatened. The two recent boat tragedies on Port Stephens, in which six people died, have made this year's blessing of the fleet all the more significant. As well as the fishing trawlers, local rescue boats joined in the sail past. The Police and Maritime Service Board launches led the 20 vessels past the head, where they were individually blessed by a local clergyman. The best decorated vessel was then chosen. It made a colourful sight as the vessels draped with streamers re-entered the harbour.
It was the running of the Australian Super Sedan Championship, and it was a top field that greeted the starter. John Pine top scored in the qualifying heats the previous night to claim the important number one grid position, and he was never headed in the race proper despite an early strong challenge from Western Australian Ben Ladlow. The hard-fought race saw numerous stoppages and several of the fancied runners crashing out, but finally it was the hard-charging Pine who crossed the line in the winning position.
Meanwhile, Englishman Ricky Willison has won the Gordon Pacific Lake Macquarie Amateur Golf Championship with a 7-under par 4-round total of 281. Willison had rounds of 70, 73, 68 and 70 to edge out overnight leader Kemp Richardson, who finished at 5-under along with Philip Tatarani of New Zealand. The best performed local was Wayne Stewart at 4-under, but it was the lad from London who repeated last year's UK victory by Russell Claydon. Ricky Willison, the Lake Macquarie champion.
Basketball is a game that also is taking on a new face, with size and strength close to the basket a big asset. It's something that coach Ken Cole is working for his Newcastle Falcons team, one of the lightest in the National Basketball League. The players in the 1990 squad are attending the Nautilus Gymnasium three times a week for an hour and a half each session to bulk up. New boy Greg Lazard is an exception to the rule, but younger players Peter Harvey, Jamie Carr and especially Neil Turner will benefit immensely from the weight and dietary program.
With Neil, we've got to try and put several extra kilos on him. So we're doing it not only in the weight training, but also in addition to him diet-wise. And so far he's progressing quite well with it.
One thing that Kevin Robbs and Ken Cole are aware of is that dramatic change is not going to happen overnight.
Sometimes it could take one or two seasons to see full results. That again depends on the individual. You'll find that some people will adapt very, very quickly, some people will take a little bit longer. But you should be really looked at a long-term thing, because with weight training, there's so many various facets in it, as far as building up the strength levels and them getting used to it. We've also got to take into consideration injuries or previous injuries they have, so in many cases the program's got to be slightly changed.
Up against players such as North Melbourne's twin bowlers Scott Fisher and Tim Dillon, Falcons giant Neil Turner has a real battle on his hands each week with his 209-centimetre, 85-kilogram frame. And he's one player that is desperate to add extra kilos. Already he feels the difference.
Well, the first 2 weeks it was much harder. However, towards the end of last week I found it making it much more easier. I had a bit more endurance in my legs and so on.
The Newcastle Knights are now fuelled up for the next three seasons with an international sponsor. The first of three $87,000 cheques was handed over today. In 1990, players will wear the green and gold BP insignia on their shoulders. Knights officials say the new deal will help pay off a $600,000 cash shortage from last year. But the search for the sponsorship dollar doesn't stop there. Knights be looking for further sponsorship at all?
I would think we would be.
Can you fit any more logos under the jumpers?
No, but we've got a ground to sell, and I think that XY Company Arena would be a great name.
Additions are being built onto the ISC grandstand to add corporate boxes valued at $13,000 per year. Meanwhile, preparations for the first trial match on Friday week against Parramatta are being hampered by injury problems. Four of the forwards are out: Johnson, Butterfield, Boyd and James Goulding. Scott Carter and Adrian Bubb are also in doubt. But blockbusting back rower David Boyd says he expects the side to be fit by the Winfield Cup.
We'll be there by the time the comp starts, and that's when you get 2 points at the end of Sunday night.
Residents on the Pacific Highway have made their feelings obvious through emotional protests and persistent lobbying. Protest leader Alison Woolley greeted news of the RTA survey with cynicism, especially as results of the study won't be made public for 4 months.
I do find it very, very frustrating that we can't get any answers till June. By then, they'll simply say that their mind has been made up. We feel that there'd be little that they could do, we could do from then on.
Well, do you think the survey, once they've done a traffic survey, surely the figures there would speak for themselves?
Figures can be interpreted in so many different ways, and if a decision has already been made, then we feel that they can look at those figures and angle them any way they feel.
Residents say the highway survey doesn't take into account pedestrian factors like the presence of high schools and primary schools right on the proposed dual carriageway. RTA Divisional Engineer Laurie Dowling says the traffic survey is comprehensive.
The factors will be the desire lines for traffic, the amount of traffic that wishes to stop and do business in Raymond Terrace, the amount of traffic proceeding through Richardson Road to the Nelson Bay area, the amount of traffic turning up into the Seaham area, Clarencetown, the amount of heavy traffic, the amount of buses, and the amount of local traffic.
He categorically denies that the RTA has already decided to build a dual carriageway through Raymond Terrace.
Well, the government has no decision. The minister has clearly stated that the purpose of the data gathering exercise has been to determine which is the best option for the use of public funds in Raymond Terrace.
Do you think the RTA has made up its mind?
Yes, I do. I firmly believe a decision to simply upgrade the current highway was made months ago.
The service will provide residents in Sydney, Wollongong, the Blue Mountains and the Central Coast with information about the movement and location of severe thunderstorms so that loss of life can be prevented and damage like this minimised. The information will be gathered through a team of radio operators who will act as storm spotters, informing the Bureau of approaching bad weather. Pictures like these produced by a radar at Mascot Airport will also indicate the intensity of rainfall. The Bureau defines a severe storm as one which brings large hail, strong winds or flash flooding.
Years ago, the council set the wheels in motion to upgrade Wyong Road into a dual carriage highway for $23 million. It normally carries 18,000 vehicles a day. The tourist season doubles that figure. The work, which began in 1988, was to take until 1995 in three stages. The initial part, more than 2 kilometres of road, is on schedule just weeks away from completion. A further 3 kilometres wasn't due to start until 1991 or 1992 because of lack of funds. But late last year, Transport Minister Bruce Baird announced money collected from the 3x3 fuel levy would be made available, allowing work to continue immediately. Work on Stage 2 will start in 11 days, with Stage 3 to follow, completing all the upgrading by 1992.
Very positive reaction from the residents. They're keen to see the road upgraded, and of course quite pleased that it will now be done approximately 3 years ahead of the early timetable.
Wyong's population is expected to increase from 100,000 to 150,000 in the next 10 years, forcing council to assess another major thoroughfare, the Entrance Road.
Few people realise it, but the section of the Entrance Road here behind us, in fact, carries more traffic than the freeway west of Wyong.
The Entrance Road carries more than 24,000 vehicles a day. A major Road and Traffic Authority study is already underway to assess its problems, but in the short term, council may have to abandon parking on congested areas and bypass shopping centres, a solution expected to prove unpopular for some.
There will no doubt be some reaction, particularly from shop owners in the shopping centre, but with the current growth of traffic on the road, we're going to have to do something about it very soon.
The showgrounds is the ideal venue for such a meeting with its long straights and speeds around 150 kilometres an hour are likely. Locals Paul Nilsson, Todd Wilshire and Sean Wilmot, the former England star, put their machines through their paces this afternoon and all enthused about the track. For youngster Todd Wilshire, it's a chance to further his reputation in front of his home crowd.
Well, it means a lot to me in my hometown now. It's been a long while since I've ridden at Newcastle here and I'm really looking forward to it and a lot of my fans will be out there hopefully and it'll mean something to me if I can win.
But the man they all must beat, and that includes the other 17 internationals competing, is the current world long track champion Simon Wigg. And after his first session on the track, signs are ominous for the opposition.
I think this probably is one of the best tracks I've ever been on. I've ridden all over the world, and it really compares with the very best I've ever been on. So it's certainly going to be, one of the best meetings I've ever ridden in.
If you are the current holder of the Commonwealth Speedway title, the British Grass Track title, and were second in the World Speedway Championships, you wouldn't think there's too much to worry about leading up to Saturday night. But Wigg has a healthy respect for his opponents in the Newcastle Masters.
With the quality of riders that the promoters have got together here, some of the very best riders I've ever seen in an individual meeting in Australia, I think the action is just going to be out of this world. It's really something to look forward to, and I certainly wouldn't have been coming all this way unless it was going to be this good.
Terry and Raylene Price have cultivated a haven for native wildlife at their 10-hectare Swan Bay property. Fervent conservationists, they've been long-time campaigners against Tomago's waste dump, which lies within 2 kilometres of their home. They and other members of the Wallaroo Environmental Group argue the dump lies on a fault line, thus poses a direct threat to the nearby Grahamstown catchment area, the source of Newcastle's water supply. With the support of local geologist Dean Crawford, they put their case to a special commission of inquiry in 1985.
Now, when he mentioned that if ever we get an earthquake in this area, they laughed at him and said that the chances of an earthquake in this area was not 1 in 10,000 or 1 in a million, it was nil. Now, this was from Michael Knight and Associates, not just a geologist, a professor of geology who teaches. Now, we all know he was dead wrong. And if they can be wrong on that subject, then what else are they wrong on?
The Price's fears are fuelled by the fact their sandstone chimney cracked during the quake. If this happened so close to the dump site, they wonder what's gone on underground. They speak only as laymen, but a geologist of 10 years' standing backs their concerns.
Obviously, once you have an earthquake and a rattling of the rocks in the ground, all these joints and faults can quite possibly become active passageways for materials to leach through.
A spokeswoman for Tomago says the dump site was inspected within 2 days of the earthquake. She says the pits remain safe, describing the environmental concerns raised as a non-story. But that assurance offers little comfort to Terry Price.